February skies are still bursting with cosmic treasures. We have fiery nebulae, glowing supernova remnants shaped like jellyfish, and delicate clouds of gas and dust resembling the helmet of an ancient god. Hi, I'm Tim, and welcome to my astrophotography channel, Cosmic Captures. In this video, I will guide you through some of the best astrophotography targets for February and how to make the most of your time under the stars. So let's get started and look at the night sky this month. When we do astrophotography, especially when planning deep sky and nightscape imaging, we want to know what the moon is doing. So let's have a brief look at the main lunar phases this month. On the first, we have a waxing crescent moon with 11% illumination. The first quarter moon is on the 5th of February, which will set in the small hours, leaving the second half of the night with dark skies. Full moon is on the 12th of February, and this is of course the most challenging time for deep sky astrophotography. And in general, I would avoid these days. But you can always try something different, like creating a beautiful image of the full moon, as I've explained in this video. The last quarter moon is on the 20th of February. And during this phase, the moon will rise late at night, so you can still capture deep sky targets in the first half of the night. And finally, the new moon is on the 28th. And this is the time most of us have been waiting for, because without moonlight, the skies will be darkest and perfect for capturing faint deep sky objects. The last few months have been really rough for astrophotography, because it feels like it has been cloudy every single night. But as astrophotographers, we have to keep hoping. So let's dive into what February has to offer for nightscapes. During twilight, on the new moon, Orion will be at its highest point in the sky. And this gives us still a great window to capture this incredible constellation with a beautiful foreground. Later in the evening, the winter Milky Way arch will stretch across the western horizon, offering another fantastic opportunity for wide-angle nightscapes. This is actually my next big project, if the skies will ever clear up again. And here's the best part about February. It's a month with second chances, because in the early morning hours, the summer Milky Way arch will begin to rise again, giving us another shot at capturing a breathtaking scene. All we need is a clear night. But now, let's move on to some of this month's amazing deep sky objects. Our deep sky journey begins with M1, also known as the Crab Nebula. This remarkable supernova remnant in the constellation Taurus is one of the most iconic deep sky objects in the winter sky. Discovered in 1731 by English astronomer John Beavis, it gained its designation when Charles Messier added it as its first object in his famous catalog in 1758. By the way, did you know how his famous catalog came about? Messier was an avid comet hunter, and when he stumbled across M1, he quickly realized it was something different. A hazy patch that didn't move like a comet. And this inspired him to create a catalog of over 100 fuzzy objects to help other astronomers avoid similar confusion. The Crab Nebula lies about 6,500 light years away and spans over 7 by 5 arc minutes, making it a relatively small but highly detailed target. It is the remnant of a massive supernova explosion recorded by Chinese astronomers in 1054 AD. And today, it continues to expand at an astonishing rate of 1,500 kilometers per second. Interestingly, M1 is the only supernova remnant in the Messier catalog, making it especially unique. For imaging M1, I recommend a setup with a smaller field of view. A telescope with a longer focal length, ideally 800 mm or more, depending on your sensor. If you don't have a setup with this reach, don't despair, because I've seen surprisingly good images from C-Star S50 smart telescopes. To capture its full beauty, narrowband filters such as hydrogen alpha and oxygen 3 can emphasize its vibrant structure and contrast. While M1 is small, it is relatively bright. But to achieve a quality image, aim for at least 2 hours of total exposure time, with sub-exposures of 3 to 5 minutes each, depending on your setup. Longer integration times will bring out the nebula's faint outer regions and enhance its dynamic colors. In February, M1 is well placed in the evening sky, giving you a perfect opportunity to capture one of the most unique and dynamic objects in the Messier catalog. We continue our journey with this month's duo, the tadpoles and the flaming star nebulae. This vibrant couple is located in the constellation Auriga, making them fantastic targets for February nights. The flaming star nebula, IC405, is about 1,500 light years away. This nebula glows beautifully as its gas is energized by a bright star called AE Auriga. The mix of red hydrogen gas emissions and blue reflection nebula light gives it a fiery appearance, hence the name. It spends around 30 arc minutes, about the size of the full moon. The tadpoles nebula, with the designation IC410, lies around 12,000 light years away and gets its name from two tadpole-shaped clouds of gas and dust within it. It's powered by a cluster of young hot stars and has an apparent size of about 40 arc minutes, a bit larger than the flaming star. Both nebulae are perfect for wide field setups, especially when captured together. For this image, I've used a 412mm telescope with an APS-C size sensor, which gave me a field of view of approximately 3 by 2 degrees. If you have a setup with a wider field of view, then you can make even more of the surrounding structures visible. And for longer focal length, you can focus on one nebula at a time and bring out more details. You can photograph both nebulae with broadband or with narrowband filters. Especially the tadpoles nebula works great with narrowband filters like H-alpha and O3. But be aware that the bluish reflection nebula filaments in the flaming star nebula will only show up with RGB imaging. With narrowband imaging, this structure will remain invisible. But you can always blend both techniques to show the best of both worlds. Auriga is high in the sky during February evenings, giving you plenty of time to capture these glowing beauties. Thor's Helmet is a striking nebula in the constellation Canis Major, located about 12,000 light years away. It gets its name because its shape resembles a Viking helmet with wings. The nebula is created by the powerful stellar winds of a Wolf-Rayet star, a massive hot star nearing the end of its life and shedding its outer layers into space. With an apparent size of around 4x6 arc minutes, Thor's Helmet is relatively small and best suited for setups with a smaller field of view, like a telescope with a focal length of 1000 mm or longer. To capture its glowing blue-green details, try using narrowband filters, especially H-alpha and O3. This means that dual narrowband filters work great. Oxygen has the strongest emission, giving the nebula its distinct blue-green glow. For Thor's Helmet, you will need longer total integration times, at least 5 hours, ideally twice as much. If you are imaging from mid to higher northern latitudes, the nebula will appear relatively low in the southern sky. However, capturing its dramatic structure and texture can be a rewarding challenge for astrophotographers. At the start of this year, I had no plans to make a monthly astrophotography overview. But here I am, bringing you the first edition of Cosmic Highlights for February 2025. And since you've made it this far into the video, chances are we share a passion for the night sky. So let's talk. I know, this isn't a new idea. Others have done similar videos for many years, and I've always enjoyed watching them. But I thought, why not give this format a try? And if you've seen any of my other videos, you know I love all aspects of astrophotography. And my goal is to make this series as universal as possible. Right now, this episode focuses on nightscape and deep sky photography, but I'd love to expand it to planetary and lunar imaging. I haven't included conjunctions or other celestial events yet, and so far my perspective is entirely from the Northern Hemisphere. But I know that astrophotographers from around the world are watching. So please tell me, what would you like to see in a monthly overview? I have over 100 video ideas, and I want to bring as many of them to life as possible. But I can't do this alone. The best way you can help me right now is by sharing this video or any of my other with friends who might find them useful. Because the more people discover and interact with this content, the better I can make it. And to all of you who have already subscribed, liked and commented, a heartfelt thank you, because your support means a lot. But now, let's jump back and explore three more amazing deep sky targets for this month. My pick for the deep sky target of the month is the Jellyfish Nebula, also known as IC443. This nebula is a stunning supernova remnant in the constellation Gemini, about 5,000 light years away. Formed by the explosion of a massive star thousands of years ago, its tangled glowing filaments resemble the tentacles of a jellyfish. With an apparent size of around 45 arc minutes, the Jellyfish Nebula covers the same area as 1.5 full moons. IC443 is an excellent and highly complex astrophotography target. For this image, I used my 412mm remote telescope paired with an APS-C size sensor. And I think this combination frames the Jellyfish Nebula really nicely, because it also covers IC444, a nearby reflection nebula. I really like how these two areas seem to be connected with a delicate structure that looks a bit like an umbilical cord. And there are plenty of molecular clouds too. You can capture the entire area with a wide field setup or zoom in on the details. There are plenty of beautiful compositions to choose from with almost any setup. To capture the rich details of the Jellyfish Nebula, use narrowband filters like H-alpha, O3 and Sulfur-2, which will highlight the glowing gases produced by the explosion. Just remember that if you want to show IC444, you must also use broadband imaging techniques, because the beautiful bluish glow of the reflection nebula will not be visible if you only do narrowband imaging. On targets like these, it really makes sense to blend both techniques. I would invest at least 10 hours on this target, and if possible more. In February, IC443 is high in the evening sky, giving you plenty of time to capture its mesmerizing structures. Very close to the Jellyfish Nebula, we can find another gem of the February night sky. It's the Monkey Head Nebula, also known as NGC 2174. This is a striking emission nebula in the constellation Orion, located 6,400 light years away. Its nickname comes from its resemblance to a monkey's head in long exposure photography. Well, I don't know if I see the monkey head, but in a closer image, I can see something that looks like the profile of a cat's head. Or, wait a minute, is it perhaps the Grinch? Can you see it? Let me know what you see in the comments below. This nebula is a stellar nursery where young stars form within clouds of gas and dust. And the radiation from these hot young stars causes the surrounding gas to glow, creating the nebula's red and orange hues. With an apparent size of about 40 arc minutes, it's large enough even for smaller setups. And with a larger telescope, you can zoom in on the nebula's details, like the dark clouds that resemble the Grinch. And since NGC 2174 is an emission nebula, it works well with narrowband imaging. Filters like H-alpha, O3, and S2 will help you bring out the nebula's fine details, especially its intricate glowing filaments. In February, the Monkey Head Nebula is well placed high in the sky, offering a perfect opportunity to capture this beautiful emission nebula. Abel 31, also known as Sharpless 290, is a planetary nebula located in the constellation Cancer. It's estimated to be about 2,000 light-years away. This nebula marks the final stages of a sun-like star's life. As the star exhausted its fuel, it shed its outer layers into space, leaving behind a hot, dense white dwarf at its center. So the glowing nebula we see today is the result of a stellar death process. Abel 31 is a beautiful target, but it's very dim. This image contains 3 hours of RGB data, and there's not that much to see. But despite its faintness, it's one of the largest planetary nebulae. For this image, I have combined 3 hours of broadband data with 6 hours of oxygen-3 and 9.5 hours of H-alpha, bringing the total integration time to 18.5 hours. And I wish I had captured at least twice as much data. With 412 millimeter focal length, my telescope is a bit underpowered. I recommend a setup with a smaller field of view to frame the nebula better, like a 1000 millimeter telescope paired with an APS-C size sensor. However, a wide field setup can capture its context in the surrounding star field, and I think it's a very pretty star field. Abel 31 is best captured with narrowband filters, especially H-alpha and O3. It's a faint but beautiful target. And February is a great time to photograph it, as it's high in the sky during the evening. If you love photographing nebulae, February is full of opportunities, but that will change next month as galaxy season begins. Right now, there's still plenty of nebulae to capture, and I've covered 5 more in my previous video. And if you'd like to learn more about the different types of deep sky objects, check out this video as well. And I hope I'll see you there. Clear skies.